was not wrong. Was not correct. It was wrong.
Okay. Oh, really?
Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey tweeted, quote, "We'll continue to point out incorrect or disputed information about elections globally." But from Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg, a different message.
I don't think that Facebook or internet platforms in general should be arbiters of truth.
As the president has waged his battle with Twitter, yesterday the U.S. passed a grim milestone, 100,000 Americans dead from COVID-19. Amidst an avalanche of tweets on other matters, the president noted the milestone in a single tweet this morning. "To all of the families and friends of those who have passed, I want to extend my heartfelt sympathy and love for everything that these great people stood for and represent. God be with you."
And Jonathan Carl joins us now. John, the president is calling on the FCC to review rules around social media companies. So how are they responding tonight? And what did the president say today about his threat to shut down Twitter?
Well, first on his threat to shut down Twitter, he was pressed on what authority he would have to shut down a private company like that. He said that he would have to ask the lawyers. Look, Lindsay, that is clearly not on the table. It is not something he's going to do. In fact, I asked him if he would even delete his own Twitter account if he's so upset with Twitter. He made it clear that's not going to happen either. After all, this is somebody who arguably got to the White House with the help of social media, specifically Twitter. As for the FCC, a decidedly non-committal answer from the chairman of the FCC, saying essentially they would carefully review any petition for rulemaking, suggesting the president's executive order is just another petition anybody would make, and said that the debate is an important one to have. But they don't seem poised to act on it at this point anyway.
And you mentioned that the president just made that brief comment marking 100,000 Americans dying from COVID-19. Some argue the president's focus on attacks on Twitter and mail-in voting, that they're just trying to distract from the administration's handling of the pandemic. Would you say that that's a fair criticism?
Well, it is notable that we passed that milestone as a country yesterday. The president didn't get around to talking about it until this morning through a tweet. He didn't speak about it before the cameras. Whether or not all the other stuff is a distraction, I frankly don't really know if you can say that, Lindsay. The president stirs up controversies all the time on Twitter. Sometimes he's distracting from bad news that's going on. Sometimes he's distracting from good news that's going on. It's just something that he does and does repeatedly.
All right, fair enough. John Carl from the White House. Thanks so much, John.
Thank you.
And for more now, let's bring in Roger McNamee, early Facebook investor and co-founder of Elevation Partners. Roger, thanks so much for being here.
Lindsay, it's a pleasure.
So you've been very critical of tech companies, Facebook in particular. What do you make of this executive order? I mean, the president likened Twitter's move to silencing or editing your phone calls. Do you think that that's fair to say?
No, it's complete and utter nonsense. And I can't believe the president really wants to do anything other than shift the attention away from the 100,000 people who have died of COVID-19. And the reason is because social media is the essence of his political strategy. I mean, he plays them like a Stradivarius. And, you know, I think what's really going on here is that he has very successfully created a distraction that the press and other policymakers and the public have moved to, so that we're not talking as much about how many people have died. And it's worked very, very well.
If you're going to fact check his tweets, then why not so many others that could also contain false or misleading information? I mean, who here is right? Well,
and the problem with this is that the implication is that if you do not fact check a tweet, then that one must be true. And in this particular context, there are falsehoods in so much of what you see on social media. I mean, the real issue here, and I think the Mark Zuckerberg piece of this is really important, because Mark is taking a position that's different from Twitter. He's basically saying, we're going to be completely hands-off, which isn't actually true, but that's what he's saying. And at the end of the day, Lindsay, the problem that we have as citizens is that social media is designed to grab our attention. And the way it does that is it shares the content most likely to provoke our emotions. That turns out to be hate speech, disinformation, and conspiracy theories. So those things get promoted by the algorithms, they get amplified, and in the process, they essentially drown out the facts. And what's really wrong at Facebook, and the thing that I think we should be focused on today, is that We have somehow converted a pandemic, which is a national health disaster, into an element of the culture war. This does not help anybody. People are dying because of this, and social media is essentially the way that this has happened. And frankly, I think Mark Zuckerberg has a lot of explaining to do, and neither of the people who interviewed him asked that question. I think that was a big failure.
And you've called for more regulation for social media companies like Twitter and Facebook. Why do they need this regulation, and what would that look like?
So, Lindsay, here's the issue that I would point to. In 1960, we began regulating chemical companies, which at that time were like internet companies. They were the fastest growing, most profitable companies in the economy. But they were spewing toxic fumes into the atmosphere where people lived. They were pouring mercury into fresh water and dumping toxic chemicals everywhere and not paying the cost. And what we have with social media is that they undermine democracy by basically making it impossible to have a good debate. They amplify the most negative signals so minorities have a disproportionate voice. And then relative to public health, they've essentially caused the response to a pandemic to be political, so that people aren't wearing masks because they view it as somehow in conflict with their political beliefs, which is unbelievably dangerous. And none of that would be true without internet platforms. And here's the point. I agree with Mark Zuckerberg. We do not want internet platforms deciding what are facts and what are not. But we also don't want them with that business model that amplifies hate speech, disinformation, conspiracy theories. So the problem isn't that the president lies or there's false information about COVID. It's that that kind of content on Facebook, on YouTube, on Instagram, on Twitter gets amplified such that it drowns out the facts. And that undermines our society. And tech is too important to let it go forward doing so much harm. So like the chemical industry in 1960, like the pharmaceutical industry in 1906, or the building trades after the great fires, we need to recognize the importance of the industry and use regulation to make sure it serves the interests of the country.
All right, Roger McNamee, really a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for your time.
It was a great pleasure, Lindsay. Thanks for having me.
And when we come back, the growing crisis at the Mexico border, long lines to enter the U.S., and the spike of COVID cases in hospitals. The soldier
that was
who
different,
saved
huh?
the day after a gunman opened fire on random drivers. And later in the show, our conversation...
Well, good afternoon, and welcome to the Howling Moon Studios, where we've just done a little bit of live TV on ABC, and we just shared that with you. We hope that was fun. It was certainly different. I was on my phone in the back room, and you'll notice I am wearing pants. When you do those live things, you don't actually have to wear pants because they only see it from about here up. But I'm wearing a tie, I'm wearing a shirt, got my usual blue jeans on, got my purple t-shirt underneath. So in that sense, it's business as usual. But now, we should do what we came here for. What do you say, Jay?
Yes, sir.
Anyway, it's really good to see you, and it's been a wild day for me. I was on CNBC at the crack of dawn, and a lot of people want to talk about Facebook and Twitter today. And you know, the thing is, you never know what's going to get people interested, but this, I don't know, maybe this will help do something good. We'll see.
It's a good segment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it was fun. They gave me a chance to actually say something useful. You know,
cool.
The key thing on a thing like that is, you know, she was going to move very slowly. We might have gotten stuck just talking about the executive order, and I had to move it straight into Zuckerberg so we could talk about the real stuff, and did give her a chance to ask a question because I was afraid she wouldn't ask the right one. What do you say?
All right.
Should we go someplace fun?
Two, three, four. When you're walking in old Shanghai, mountains under the night sky, see the moon begin to rise, just like it did back home. Old men smoking in cafes, junk boats floating on the bay. Think of me while you're away in old Shanghai. With no ties, with no plans. Your last dollar in your hands. Take a picture and send it back to someone you used to know. Things will always find their way from the back roads to the bay.
Making the phase shift from politics to music,
yeah,
is not seamless.
Yeah, it must be a weird transition.
Oh my God, it's like, you know, they different parts of the brain.
Well, the next time you go on like a book tour, you should like play songs in between.
Well,
like,
so
incorporate your music into it.
We actually looked at doing that, right? And there was some demand, and I did do a couple times.
But so how was that? How was that transition? Like,
well, I mean, I made it work because I only did one or two songs each time.
Yeah.
And it wasn't a surprise was the key thing, right? I mean, see, the thing is, guys, we didn't know I was doing the TV thing until an hour ago. And so that was like, oh. I better put some fancy dress on. You ready?
I am.
All right, I want to send this one out to Leah.
Someday soon.
was just as wild in his younger days. So blow, you rolling northern, blow my love to me. He's riding in tonight from California. He loves his damned old rodeo. Going with him someday soon.
By Ian Tyson of Ian and Sylvia and We Five fame, and made a hit by Judy Collins, which is where I learned it.
So great the other day.
That thing he's put his foot on is called a phaser, made by MXR. It's like one of the classic 70s pedals, and I thought it sounded so amazing. I thought I gotta get it.
Yeah, Tim.
It was like the first pedal I ever had, and I probably haven't had one since 1980.
Yeah, Tim gave me that.
Okay.
All right. Everywhere. And with the
a feeling that you give. You said those words were all for me to say. Then
them places.
One of them there places.
When my songs turn to ashes on my tongue, when I look in the mirror and see I'm no longer young, then I got to start the job of separating false from true. Then I know I need the love of you. When I found tarnish some of my brightest dreams, when some folks I trusted turned out not quite what they seemed, then I got to start the job of separating false from true. And then once more I know I need the love of you. Song I sing will make Governor Wallace change his mind. No song I sing will take the gun from a hate-filled man. But I promise you and you, brothers and sisters of every skin, I'll sing your story while I've got breath with you.
Birthday to Pete, by the way, a couple days later. When was his birthday? Yesterday?
Yes.
Yesterday.
That would be Pete Sears. I was actually talking about Pete Seeger.
Oh, you're talking about Pete Seeger.
But, you know, he got both the same first name, the same first
right.
beginning of the last name. But yes, yesterday was the birthday of our bandmate and dear friend, Pete Sears. And we just want to send a massive shout out to Pete because he is... He's just such a beautiful human being. He's an amazing musician, obviously, but, you know, he's such a great person that we hope the coming year brings you great joy, good health, and will be your best one yet, Pete.
You know.
was something.
It was something. I got a lot of pedals going on down here.
No, that was epic. I mean, that was totally great.
I added a sustain pedal for the Mellotron. So,
well, it clearly worked.
Well, yeah, so it's work in progress.
Yeah. All I can tell you folks who are musicians, hanging with this guy is the luckiest thing that ever happened to me.
And, oh, shit.
You know, it's like, I'm just like, I get to sit here and watch this stuff. The next thing we're going to do, we're actually going to fix up the inner workings of the studio, which are so old and so archaic that there's just wires everywhere. It's a mess. And we figured out how to, like, fix it up without violating quarantine. And so that's one of our projects, because that way Jason and I will be able to go in there and really make serious stuff.
Yeah.
And it's very cool because it's been so long since we did this that almost every piece of the studio has shrunk by roughly half. So the band's going to have way more space than it's historically had, because we're probably going to get a new mix board, because the new one is not only better, but it's tiny.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So,
and,
yeah.
And
free up space.
Giant rack of Mike Preez is going away completely, because the new thing is one rack. It's like a one-U thing.
Got it.
I mean, it's wild. And, you know, we'll have to put a little bit of money into it, but the payoff will be huge. And then it'll be much easier to reconfigure. And in theory, we'll be able to walk in there, like do a rehearsal and press one button.
And be recording to Pro Tools.
Recording into Pro Tools with all the tracks.
Right.
That's assuming we do this right, which there's no guarantees we'll do it right. But we're going to try.
Cool.
So let's do some abiding here.
All right, then. 2, 3, 4. Now you're unloading.
picture floating on the Sea of Galilee. Walk on water, turn wide to water, lay down your song at Peter's gate. You're a saint.
Some songs we were planning to play yesterday on Tuesday, in our enthusiasm and our excess verbiage, we had to drop so that there would be time for Lebo to play. And we hope all of you enjoyed Lebo playing. I thought his version of Row, Row, Row Your Boat was particularly excellent. And I detected the fine work of his daughter in that rewriting of the lyrics. Anyway, playing this song because we just passed this massive milestone, 100,000 people. And the reality is, it's actually much more than that, right? That when you look at the number of people who passed away who would not normally have done so, that number is over 130,000. So we want to sing a song for all of them.
Elvis played and it pleased the Lord. You don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king, pausing, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to your kitchen chair, she broke your throat, she cut your hair. From your lips she drew the thank you. If I did, well, really, what's it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter which you heard, the holy or the broken. Hallelujah. 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 Did my best, wasn't much, couldn't feel, so I tried to touch, told the truth, I didn't mean to fool you. And even though it all went wrong, I knew before the Lord of song went nothing on the time, but hallelujah, hallelujah.
One second. Oh, you hear that?
Let's send them off for all day. Is the issue not enough oomph? What's the...
Now that. Do you hear that noise?
I do hear that noise. People pay a lot of money for that.
This is a brand new keyboard.
I know.
I don't think it's the keyboard, though, because this is all coming through clean. I think it's the channel of this mixer, so I'm just going to swap out channels.
So we are having technical difficulties, which should take only a moment to fix. In the meantime, we hope you'll enjoy this verbal programming for me. You can watch Jason, of course, as he replugs that thing. But, you know.
It's still making that noise.
Huh?
Perhaps it's this pedal. Let's see if it makes... That's clean.
I agree.
It's the pedal.
Can we get a new one?
Oh, yeah.
Thank God. I would tell you. We otherwise, we're going to have to, like, stop playing music forever.
I actually I have one in that box right there that was headed for the Mellotron, but I can assign
it. But it's going to get short-circuited by the...
I can assign it to this guy.
Yeah.
But I can make it through these next few songs. No problem. Where are we? Well.
All right, I want to send this one out to Janet, who requested it. Thank you.
my pretty Alice in every headline.
I've been from Tucson to Tucumcari, carry to Hatchet Beat a ton of park. Driven every kind of rain that's ever been made. Driven on the back roads to a wooden getaway. And if you give me whites and white, and you show me a sign, I'll be willing to keep moving.
Yeah, I was like, man, he's giving me a long time to solo at the beginning.
Yeah, but your solo was beautiful. And I just, so for those of you who know, I mean, I've played that song since it was new. And until I started playing with Jason, I always sang the harmony, so I forgot that I had to go first. Whose birthday is it today, Jay?
It is John Fogerty's 75th birthday.
And what are we going to do about that? You're going to sing Happy Birthday?
You're going to sing the song.
I'm going to sing. Okay, but I'm not going to sing Happy Birthday. We're going to sing
It's your choice.
No, I'm going to sing.
But what's on the set list is you singing one of his tunes.
Mm-hmm.
you're right. There's a bad moon on the rise.
Influential Creedence was in my life, and I suspect the lives of pretty much everybody else who aspired to play guitar
or turned on the radio
in the late 60s. Yeah, certainly anybody turned, but if you're going to play guitar, the man was the riff machine. And you sit there for a band that, in a sense, didn't really have a lead guitar player in the traditional sense. It's amazing how the riffs were. I mean, not quite the Beatles, but for the United States of America, pretty amazing.
Yeah.
And there was a 2 or 3 year period there where they had so many top 10 hits. I mean, just truly epic songs that, you know, you think of that one, but I mean, how many people would say that was the best song you wrote? Hardly anybody, right? I mean, they sit there and go, have you ever seen The Rain, or We'll Stop the Rain, or, you know, it, I mean, it's like, what's the one about the riverboat?
I don't know.
It doesn't matter. And, you know, just so many great songs.
I honestly didn't really, I just knew the songs from, like, you know, from the radio.
Yeah.
Like, I never really had any Creedence records. Yeah. But then in The Big Lebowski, when, like, they find all of the Creedence cassette tapes around the cops, you know, like, yeah, you know. Oh, when his car gets stolen, he's like, man, my Creedence tapes were in there. And the cops are like, I don't know if we're going to get the Creedence tapes back. I was like, I got to check out these Creedence guys.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's you know, if you don't feel like buying all the albums, just get the greatest hits because
right.
They're Proud Mary. That's the name of the riverboat one. Proud Mary. I mean, that was huge. That was covered so many times. Some of the covers were, I mean, Tina Turner did a cover of Proud Mary.
Yeah, that's killing me. Yeah.
Completely. I mean, I think she might have had a top 10 hit with it.
I think so.
Maybe even a number one. I mean, it was gigantic. You know, Willie and the Poor Boys. I mean, oh, that's such a great song.
Yeah, I'd be curious which of those charted higher. Yeah. Their version or Tina Turner's version.
Theirs was huge, but I think Tina might sold have. More copies because, yeah. I mean, she was Tina Turner, for Pete's sakes. And, man, he put her voice. I mean, that was the thing about John, right? Was he was a white guy singing black, right? He had that Elvis thing going. You know, the thing that I always coveted, but obviously I'm way too white to have that.
All right, I'm gonna try this on the Nashville because I think it might sound cool.
Shatter before you're walking on splinters, your head aches just to feel what it knows. Please leave a light on when you go. How can you fix something that you can't touch without hurting? The lesson you've learned is leaving you dumb. Please leave a light on when it's done. Standing high above the flood. All your belongings go by.
What's up?
watching all your belongings go by. How can you fix the ending when you're lost at the beginning? The days hide all that the night left behind. Please turn a light on when it dies.
Nice. That has potential.
Yeah.
Finger picking Nashville thing.
Well, and fun to be able to be the one playing the solo as a spy test there.
You've had a lot of solos today. I like that.
Yeah,
I
wasn't expecting that and don't expect it to ever happen again.
Well, I think you used to solo on that back in the...
I did. I used to solo on a lot of the things that we did that were either back or... Right, because I couldn't play the rhythm well enough, so you wind up having to play the rhythm and everything.
And also, we also used to just play two guitars. I never really played any other instruments when we first started. Just a guitar duo thing.
Anyway, we were looking at the song list, and it turns out that while we have a theme song in this band, we have not been playing it lately. It's been basically a month since we last played it, so we're playing it today. And that's pretty much how it goes. And this is really a salute to all the people I was talking about on TV earlier. Right? They're the ones who desperately need this song. And the last verse in particular is for them.
It's essential.
I want to see a wise old woman to ask her what to do. She said there's only one thing works for me, but it might just work for you. Take a couple of puffs. Yes, a couple of puffs. That's just enough. Yes, a couple of puffs. No matter what, no matter when, on cannabis you can depend. Make each moment happy as can be. Take a couple of puffs. Couple of puffs when I wake up starts my day how to write. A couple more with breakfast helps my appetite. A couple of puffs before I face the world makes the sunshine bright. Well, I'm so glad to be alive. Let me share my life. Take a couple of puffs. Yes, a couple of puffs. Just enough. Yes, a couple of puffs. No matter what, no matter when, on cannabis you can depend. To make each moment happy as can be. Take a couple of puffs. A couple of puffs with the one I love, like fine champagne from France. Couple of puffs with my doctor and the guy who feeds the plants. A couple of puffs with the policeman, he's cool, he'll take a chance. He's so glad to be alive. Do the puffs, then pass, then dance. Take a couple of puffs. Yes, a couple of puffs. That's just enough. Yes, a couple of puffs. A couple of puffs.
next thing pretty fast. A couple of puffs in Silicon Valley, so the bad guys finish last. A couple of puffs for all the folks who'd benefit from rounds. Yes, a couple of puffs, but that's just enough. Yes, a couple of puffs. No matter what, no matter when, on cannabis you can depend to make each moment happy as can be. No matter what, no matter when, on cannabis you can depend.
We're done with 3 minutes to spare.
All right. T-Sisters will be on Moon Owl's streaming platform.
They will be on very soon. The T-Sisters with their weekly Thursday gigs. And if you have not seen these things, they are truly fantastic. They are family entertainment, and they're funny as all get out. Combination of music and great sets, hilarious costumes, and they are just incredibly funny people and beautiful and wonderful. We love them. So I want to thank ABC News for putting me on their streaming service at exactly 4:20 p.m. Pacific time, because that was my first time doing something for them, and the fact that they were with it enough to pick that hour as the moment speaks volumes. And, you know, I got to be honest with you, they're part of the Walt Disney Company. I was not anticipating them being woke on that topic, and perhaps they're not, but they're at least there.
Discussing it is a good step.
When they said, I asked what time you want to do this, they said, well, 4:20 your time. I'm going, this is too good to be true. I could not say no. Anyway, thank you all for watching. Have a great time with the T-Sisters. We promise it'll be good. We haven't seen it, of course, because it's live, but we know it'll be good. Anyway, we'll see you again. Tomorrow I've got a solo show, and then we'll be back on Sunday, right? Or are you solo Sunday? We're back Monday. We're back on Monday. So I'm solo tomorrow. I'm solo Saturday. Jason solo Sunday. We'll be back on Monday, and with who knows what. But I'm very excited for the solo shows. Hope you will be too. Have a lovely evening, and we'll see you tomorrow. Take care.